Shesulen es en Britannia. Tinyatoyan se sea weyai an yanai with washanethlea. Otwethleng sia yau. Ti poyae yau huitiung hoa. Otian weyweth. Word order in sentences. Being, doing, and having. Asking and answering questions. Defining relationships between words and phrases. The basic word order in Xi'an is VSO. This means that the V, the verb, comes first, and then the S, the subject, and then at the end, the O, the object. Now, there are some exceptions to this, or what seem like exceptions to this, but we'll tackle them when we get there. First, let's look at the most basic thing, being. With this word being, we refer to I am, you are, it is, etc. There are only 9 verbs in Xi'an, but 3 of those are related to what we think of in English as being. So let's dive in and see how Xi'an is special in this regard. We'll start with the verb lo, which defines the subject as belonging to a category of things. To express I am human, we start with the verb lo. Then comes the subject noa, the pronoun for first person singular I. And finally, we need the object, or in this case, the predicate, human. So, lo noa human means I am human. But we need to understand that in the Xi'an mind, this more literally means I belong to the class of fellow beings defined as humans. Let's look at some more examples. Lo le nya yan. Lo le nya yan. You are a student. Notice that the verb does not conjugate. In English, the verb changes depending on the subject. Xi'an does not do this. Lo is always lo for any person or thing. Lo lui keth. A knife is a simple weapon. Based on our word order, you can deduce that the word lui here is representing knife, and keth means a simple weapon. The pronoun for they is selan. How would you guess that you'd say they are students? The term for student is nyayan. Give it a go. Did you guess lo selan nyayan? If so, you are correct. You don't need to make nyayan for student plural. It's understood from context. This is another fundamental of the language. Now let's look at the verb ti. It will seem similar to lo to you coming from English, but for the Xi'an, it's quite different. When I introduced myself earlier in the chapter, I said something along the lines of Ti noa nyatoyan seseya. Nyatoyan means teacher. Seseya refers to you plural, or y'all in my birth dialect. So, Ti noa nyatoyan seseya was meant to express I am your teacher. In this lesson, it turns out that you don't have another teacher. I'm the only one. So you could think of this as I am the teacher for you for this lesson. Xi'an does not have the articles that we do in English, a and the, but it can partially express the meaning that we put into those words with its verb distinction of lo versus ti. Imagine that you are sitting in a classroom and a stranger shows up and says, lo noa nyatoyan. That's all she says. From this, she has told you that she is a teacher. However, if she had said ti noa nyatoyan, you would know that she was going to be the teacher for the class and there won't be any other teachers assisting. If a child were to say ti noa nye sunath, you would know that sunath doesn't have any other children. Ni means direct offspring. E sunath relates ni to her. What does lo noa nye sunath imply? Did you get it? Sunath in this case has other children, and the child belongs to that group or category of people, Sunath's children. It will require a tiny bit of rewiring of your brain to learn to use lo and ti properly, but in the end, it's not that difficult. Now let's talk about the other sense of being, having the quality of X or Y or Z. When something is big in size, sawo, or yellowish in color, kuth, it has that as one of its qualities. For this, the Xi'an use the verb e, But there is a twist. Esawothlan. She or he is tall. Ekuth Yalma. The animal is xanthic, meaning yellowish in color. Did the word order throw you? It does seem counterintuitive based on our VSO, verb subject object rule. The reason for this is that with e, the quality that the subject possesses binds with the verb e. So think of she is tall more like is tall she, or the animal is yellowish as is yellowish the animal. It's kind of Yoda grammar from an English speaker's perspective, because the verb comes at the beginning, bound to the attribute, and the subject follows. We're technically getting a verb-subject sentence, and that's enough to convey the meaning while following the basic rules of the language. This structure in the language will be a bit confusing at first, but like the Lowell versus T distinction, you'll eventually get used to it. So we've learned about 30% of the verbs in the core set that the language has to offer. Let's contrast them again with each other to clarify. Lo, be, belong to a class of things. T, be, equal a specific person or thing. E, be, emanate a characteristic or attribute. All of these are commonly translated into English as be, that is, am, is, are. But the Xi'an perceive them very differently. Now let's look at not being or lacking attributes. We already covered this in a previous lesson a bit, but let's review. Lo lai, not be, not belong to a class of things. Ti lai, not be, not equal to a specific person or thing. Eyo, not be, not emanate a characteristic or attribute. The form elai is possible, but uncommon, and used to convey subtleties of meaning for more advanced levels of communication. We'll skip that for now. Here are some more examples with lo, ti, and e. Lo lai kuketh. It is not a weapon. Ti lai kumketh. They are not the weapons being discussed. Eyo sawo reith. Reith is not tall. Literally, reith emanates a lack of size. Next, let's talk about parts of speech in Xi'an. There are clearly verbs, and there are names of things that are clearly nouns, and there are several words that relate things to each other, which when talking about Xi'an grammar, we call relationals in English, or sometimes clarifying particles. But we can't really discuss the fundamental way the language works without understanding what a tai is. The best translation of tai in English is probably elemental, but that's a kind of unwieldy word. So let's just learn what a tai is and call it a tai. They are meaning words, for lack of a better description. They work as nouns, adjectives, adverbs, and bind with verbs. E, that we just learned about, is a typical example. Tai typically give the verbs their content meanings. Let's look at the tai ki, for example. A table can be useful. Ki is the raw tai representing the idea of breath. Kyuki is a noun, the air involved in breathing. Eki is a verb, the breathing that humanoids do involuntarily, constantly. Oki is also a verb, but refers to the intentional breathing, in or out, exhaling, inhaling of air or gas, etc. Another eki works as an adjective, referring to anything related to breathing. Uki is essentially an adverb expressing something done through a breathing process. Toki is another verb expressing that someone or something is respirating someone else to keep them alive, for example. Aki is a single breath. Aki eloa would mean 9 countable breaths. A tai can be comprised of a single syllable or more than one. Ki is just one syllable, as is kuth that we learned for yellowishness. However, sawo for bigness or tallness or largeness is 2 syllables, as is kuya, which you may remember for rudeness from an earlier lesson. In English, we can hold a knife as a noun or knife someone in the back as a verb, or sharpen a knife blade, where knife is an adjective describing the type of blade. This concept should not be completely alien to you. Just be prepared to see Tai doing all kinds of different things in Xi'an. This brings us to our next verb, O. You have learned it already in Okuya, commit some rudeness, and Otangwe, make a request or ask for something. Like the verb E, O binds with a Tai to form verbs of doing. Let's look at several more examples. Onal, pilot or drive something in 3D space. Oloa, eat or drink something. Owoa, speak a language, etc. Owai, go somewhere. Otion, come, as in arrive at a location. Okya, fight or do battle. Oti, put something away or hide or conceal something. This final example here is most interesting. Ti is the Tai for some kind of containment or pocket. We might say, he pocketed the cash in English. So it kind of sounds familiar, right? One of the most common Tai in Xi'an is the one for personhood, nya. If you wanted to talk about a pilot, you'd likely use the compound of the two Tai, nya and nal, to produce a single word, nya nal. A huge number of terms given in the dictionary are listed as elemental compounds. Most compounded Tai can work as if they were a regular or basic Tai, as long as they make some kind of logical sense in context. For example, to convey that Wraith will be doing the piloting on this mission, you might just say, Onyanal Wraith. Let's go back to the verb e for a second before we move on to questions. Sometimes the idea of what an object is quite different in English when compared to Xi'an. In English, in this sentence, I don't understand the Xi'an language. We feel like the Xi'an language is the object of the verb to understand. The Xi'an don't see it this way at all. In their mind, they emanate a lack of grasping of the language. We learned eyonai for don't understand way back in chapter 1. Let's look at an example where we call out specifically what is not understood. Eyo enai e wo xian mari. Or simply, eyonai wo xian mari. Mari does not understand Xi'an. What's literally happening in this sentence is Marie emanates lack of grasp of Xi'an. So it's technically a really long verb and its short subject, Marie. The Xi'an drop the relational E between yo and nai and wo xian in most cases because it's understood to be there. It's redundant. Now, if you're thinking to yourself, wait, isn't A a verb that comes at the beginning? What's going on? There is an answer. The verb e, spelled with this letter in Xi'an, is a verb. The relational particle, spelled without the inverted L-like element in Xi'an, is different. They historically came from the same Tai, but today their roles in the sentence are different. More on the relational e, the simpler one, coming up. For now, let's look back at the idea of having in Xi'an. They see it as emanating possession of something. The Tai for possession is pronounced run. Erun lui Wraith. Wraith has a knife. He owns one. Erun san noa. I have a vehicle. Erun yalma isho human. Humans have pets. Literally, house animals. Notice in the last example here that the relational particle e is kept in the idea of yalma isho. Sho is the Tai for home or domestic. You now know 4 of the 9 Xi'an verbs, lo, ti, e, and o, and you understand how Tai bind with e and o to broaden the expressiveness of the language. So we've got several verbs to work with. Now let's look at asking questions in more detail. Do you recall the little question word na from the last chapter? It's used to form yes-no questions, and typically comes right after the verb. Lo na reith nyanal, is reith a pilot? Ti na reith nyanal yeo, is reith the pilot today? En na run san ong reith, does reith have a personal vehicle? O na nyanal utung reith, does reith typically do the piloting? Let's answer these questions. The primary way to do this in Xi'an is by repeating the verb to mean yes and negating the verb for a no. Lo na reith nyanal. Lo, yes, he is. Ti na reith nyanal yeo. Ti, yes, he is. Or ti lai, or just lai, for no, he is not. E na rung san ong reith. Eh. Yes, he does. Yo, no, he does not. O na nyanal utung reith. Oh, he does. Lie, no, he doesn't. If you answer an ebe's question with lie, the Xi'an will understand, but they may read too much into it. When lie is used to negate the verb e, it generally means that something is not as it is expected to be. So try to use yo. It's more generic and useful. The Xi'an will almost always use yo to negate e. You learned in an earlier lesson that you can also use tlea, proper or correct, to answer yes, but it's better to get in the habit of repeating the verb for normal grammatical cases. Now let's look at pure question words. In English, they often begin with WH. Who, what, when. In Xi'an, they always end in shōa. Nya shōa, who, which person. A shōa, what, which concrete thing. Po shōa, which abstract thing or event or idea. Shi shōa, when, at which point in time. Ka shōa, where, which place. Mue shōa, how, which method. Kui shōa, how much, what volume or quantity. Sua shōa, how long, what amount of time. Tia shōa, what type, which type. When you ask a question with an overt question word formed with shōa, you do not use na. Ti nya shōa reith, who is reith. E ka shōa kawa, where is kawa. O nya nal umu shōa reith. How is Wraith at piloting? Lo aya ashoa. What are those things over there? Lo yalma ele tashoa. What kind of animal is yours? Finally, when you're talking about several different things, shoa can come after the relational particle e to mean which. Ti yalma eshoa thlan ele. Which pet or animal among those here is yours? Let's wrap up with a more detailed discussion of relational particles. E and U are the two most statistically common. That said, be aware that they drop out a lot. Let's take a look. E is used most commonly for what we think of as forming adjectives. Ekuth, yellowish. And everyday possession in the sense of my, your, John's, etc. Sanong ereith. Wraith's ride, his personal vehicle. It typically does not drop out when it's performing these functions. U illustrates overt adverbial modification. Onal u leth wraith. Wraith flies fast. U drops all the time. Onal leth wraith. This is not unlike dropping ly on adverbs in English. Do it quick, please, instead of do it quickly. And when you have to be very specific about qualities of things and their relationship to each other, you also need to understand about we and se. We extends a relationship. Echi heng sanong ekuth we reith. Reith's yellow ride is currently broken. The vehicle is yellow and belongs to Reith. It is not the same yellow color that Wraith is, even if Wraith happens to be such a color. The relational particle se is used when the thing being discussed is related to a group of people. She's a human. Human children. She a human eyo, the child belonging to that human near you. Let's finish by looking at a few other important relational particles. Ka, location, in, at, on. T, using, with, as in a tool. So, accompanying, with a person. Nui, for, toward, in the direction of. Let's hear these in examples. Opa loa kasan Wraith. Wraith ate in the vehicle. O loa tino shira, human. Humans sometimes eat with their hands. O wai so sunath Wraith. Wraith will go with sunath. Opa loa Wraith with ten enui sunath. Wraith ate the food that was intended for sunath. The two most important things to note about the last example here is first, that the direct object of what Wraith ate is marked with weth. As another example, Wraith piloted the vehicle would be Opa na Wraith with san. Wraith directly influenced the vehicle in this case, so it takes weth to clarify that. Second, when relational particles clarify the attributes of tai used as nouns, they often take e to overtly clarify the relationship. Ten enui sunath refers to the food intended for sunath, essentially her food. We won't go through all of them now, but you can find copious other relational particles in the dictionary to help you express the meanings you want to convey. A lot of these equate to prepositions in English, though in Xi'an, that's not always precisely the case. That brings us to the end of your first full foray into Xi'an grammar. Congratulations. This is not all of it, of course, but please go engage at the forum on the RSI website and ask questions. In the next lesson, we'll tackle the Xi'an sense of propriety and politeness and how that plays out in the language's verbs and pronouns.